as it was mentioned, I will speak about energy and sustainable development, and I try to keep climate out of my talk as much as possible. The energy is one of the most fundamental physical reason for sustainable development, and that is also indicated in the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, namely to ensure access to affordable, so cheap, energy resources. Some of the energy sources are very expensive, like windmills, I will speak about it. Reliable, some of the energy sources are not very reliable and they are producing energy not when it is needed, but random times. Sustainable, I will describe immediately what is sustainable and it should be modern, like the most recent energy resources are nuclear, fusion and fission. So, I will speak about some of the information which is provided by Academia Europea, which has a group of interested members of the Academy regarding energy and sustainable development, and many different publications, both public as well as scientific, can be seen in the in the web page which is indicated there. So in the last or previous Blue Sky Conference, I spoke about sustainable development. I don't want to repeat it, just the very basic conclusions. One can even see it on the previous page, the whole talk. So just very briefly, there is a definition which most people use, the about sustainable development. It's very important that we have don't have to use the sustainability because that's misleading. We don't want to speak about sustainable stagnation and we don't want to have sustainable degradation, which some people actually have having aids which are pointing in that direction. Gro Harlem Brundtland has the definition in the committee organized by the United Nations that this development should meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to put their own needs. This is not a very scientific definition. It is kind of a feeling, or but it's not kind of, you cannot really quantitatively say that what should we do. Schrödinger made a much better definition already much before in 1944 in his book, which is entitled What is Life? And he connected the evolution or the development to the complexity, and he used the word orderliness, and that can be measured by the physical quantity, which most people don't know. If you have a low entropy material that is highly and very regularly organized. So low entropy, the direction of the development is going in the physical quantity, which is lower, so one can this is a measurable quantity, well-defined methods are how to measure it. The second issue is that the way to reach development, sustainable development, in the situation where we have no increasing amount of resources, is to make the material more complex. This more complex material is actually sitting here in the room. Particularly our brains, that is the most complex material which is easy to calculate. And we did it. Unfortunately, Schrödinger in his time had no information. He had information about ideal gases and different materials, and you see if the materials are getting to be more complicated, then the entropy for 1 kilogram of that material in joule per Kelvin is decreasing. If we get to the DNA of the simplest molecule, that is Candidatus Cartonia rudi, that is already a very, very little number, 10 to minus, that is about almost a million in the exponent. And of course, Schrödinger did not know anything about the DNA, so he could not calculate it. And if we go the lowest entropy what we can estimate today is actually the brain tissue of the human brain, and that is a number, which is, I cannot even tell how small number it is. This is described in this publication in the bottom for those who are interested. Now, the last question Schrödinger discussed is that, do we need, and this was also discussed in the previous day, do we need a separate law to describe that we have this feature on the Earth? And we have this development. Obviously, we are here, so something is happening. Do we need a new law of nature or law of physics to tell that? His conclusion was that no, we don't know. But the Earth is having a relatively constant energy content and temperature, and the energy out to the cosmos or to the space is roughly the same. On the other hand, the sun has typically a temperature of 6,000 Kelvin. The sun is around 300 Kelvin. That is the temperature roughly here, right? Now, and therefore, as which is defined by the amount of heat divided by the temperature from the sun, and very large, which is going out. So, okay. So the boundary condition, constrained amount of material and surface territory, we have to have a decreasing entropy, therefore we have development. The role of water was already discussed in the previous talk. Actually, the fact that the water is a huge amount of water is on the Earth, particularly on the surface, in three different phases, then the change of the amount of ice, water, and water vapor is acting as a thermostat. That keeps the temperature of the Earth stable, so that is actually the most important feature of the water, and that therefore we have to keep it that way. If all the ice is melting, that will lead to trouble, but it is still far from away, and although the Arctic is doing what you said, but the Antarctica does the other way. So the sea level indicates actually the real speed of global warming or the ice balance, and that is measured even in the last 100 or even 1,000 years, although there are not too much records from the 1,000 years, that the change is about 1 to 2 millimeters per year. And that means that we will have a 1 or 2 meter of sea level change in about 1,000 years. So that is not so tragic, I would say. So that, so much right now about water. So the in the sustainable development, we have to also ensure that we have to get rid of the entropy, which we produce extra entropy, because otherwise this boundary condition would be violated. Only the Earth has this good feature, for example, in the solar system. Mars or Venus doesn't have this amount of water which would act as a thermostat, therefore they are reflecting back the solar radiation and there is no constant temperature, typical temperature emission. So we have to make sure, or we have to act in a way that we do not produce unnecessarily extra entropy, and that is what I am going to speak about, but try to keep it as little as possible. So what are the fundamentals of energy, which is actually the topic of my talk? So this was just the repetition of my last talk. So what is the relation between energy and entropy? First of all, you may know that there are two types of energy, what we can speak about, and they are not the same. One is heat, and the other one is mechanical energy. Heat is probably understood by everybody. Mechanical energy is not only the mechanical energy that I move this microphone or a car is moving, but mechanical energy is all kinds of kinetic energy, potential energy, electric energy. Also, natural sources of nature have this mechanical energy, like water, wind, and rain, lakes at high altitudes. These are all natural sources of energy, and these are all mechanical energy. So we can get energy if we need from heat, which we take different fuels, like just like it is generated in the sun, or we have the natural sources of mechanical energy from nature, and we convert it into useful mechanical energy, so mechanical to mechanical. And then if we use heat, which is actually the majority of the present energy sources, like oil, coal, we burn it, we destroy actually the original more complex material and get some less complex one that is producing extra entropy a lot, and the effectivity of that production is limited by the so-called Carnot effectivity, which is around 15% to 40%. So the other part, the remaining, is actually converted into extra entropy, which understood more or less that is extra heat. The mechanical energy can be converted, and that is where we are at an important point, that whether it is having a good effectivity or a bad one. And there are different sources, and that is actually the detailed subject of my talk, that we would like to convert the existing natural kinetic and mechanical energy into usable kinetic energy with at least loss and least waste heat production. So I already mentioned that the sun produces actually this, all the wind, the rain, that you have water at high altitudes. So this is all produced by the sun and by the fact that the Earth is rotating and you have sunny side and the shady side, and then of course this creates differences in pressure and so on. Electromagnetic radiation is also frequently not thermal. From the sun it is thermal, but from example a radio station it is a very well regulated one frequency that can be transferred is 100% efficiency. The wind is a very interesting feature. It can be transformed with very high efficiency, I will discuss it, but also in very bad efficiency, and that is actually one of the important issues I want to say. Okay, so we have tried to avoid the waste heat production. So then let's discuss some specific energy sources. One of the nicest and most practical way of using energy coming actually from the rain in big rivers or lakes, one of the best example is the Three Gorges Dam in China on the Wuhan River, which has an energy production of 22 gigawatt. Now, I am sorry for those who don't know these numbers, what is a megawatt, tera, giga, peta, and so on. I cannot explain it now, but it comes in this sequence that kilo, mega, giga, tera, peta. So these are always three orders of magnitude bigger than the other one. And then there are many such power stations which are very essential. It's important that one present modern nuclear power station is about 1 gigawatt production and it operates permanently. The water dams are even better because they can be regulated according to the demand, according to the consumption. So the water power is actually the best situation because it produces energy for you when you need it and exactly the amount what you need. So water power stations are absolutely the best. It can also be used to store energy that you pump up the water to high altitudes and then you use again the energy when it is needed. So the efficiency of the water energy, is actually quite good. Almost 100%, like the biggest turbine at the Three Gorges Dam, which I just mentioned, is one single turbine, which is on that picture, that makes almost 800 megawatt energy, so almost as much that single turbine makes almost as much energy as a nuclear power station. Another one is another kind of turbine. This the upper one is a Francis turbine, the other is a Pelton turbine, which makes also half a megawatt. This is in Switzerland, and also the efficiency is 95%. So these are well-regulatable and very high power stations. The other were, for example, the wind is used is here, the America's Cup racing boat, which with wind power can make very good efficiency, 100 kilometer per hour speed on water with about 10 or 20 passengers on it. So that is not a small boat. So that is a very interesting way and a good way to converting wind energy. There are other efficient ways of using water energy when it is not closed at low speeds, for example, tidal sets and tidal water power stations, which are not as good as these previous ones, but they are still very good. Now, the other very good or relatively good way of making energy is solar panels, which have an efficiency of about 20-30%. In principle, they could reach maximally a 40% level, but that's already difficult and very expensive. These are having one problem. They are, they are absolutely perfect if we put it on the top of the roof or on roads or parking places. There are many examples of that, but not so good if you put it on agricultural land, because this is immediately violated by the basic principle of Schrödinger, that the high complexity, which is much more valuable, where you have plants which actually absorb CO2 also, by the way, they are actually prevented from operation, and therefore the production of that relatively little energy per surface is not really worth it. So solar panels are usually good, but not always. The efficiency of solar power, if in the case of you would take, for example, 1 terawatt hour energy, that is a unit of energy, quite a bit of energy, and we will see that how much 1 terawatt hour, how much energy or how much waste heat is done. If we just waste all of it, then we get about 12,000 gigajoule per Kelvin extra entropy. Now, the efficiency, for example, of the photovoltaic with 10 or 20% efficiency, that's the usual one, makes quite a bit, not completely. It makes 9,000 gigajoule per Kelvin, and the best efficiency would be 7,000 gigajoule per Kelvin. So we have to look at how much waste heat these different sources are making. One can also see that, for example, a similar machine which doesn't make energy but uses energy, very small size, and it can have at this small size 80 megawatt energy. So the another interesting use, actually it is taken from a lecture of János Áder, to put solar panels on the sea, on the surface of the sea. Again, this is a good way of producing energy if the bottom of these panels is actually transparent and not, let's say, a black metal, because then the life under the sea is maybe a little bit getting less light, but it's not killed completely, so therefore that there is no negative effect. So then let's come to the wind power, which is having, I would say, double trouble. One is that the wind is not blowing when we want to have it, particularly not following the needs of the population. And then at the time, particularly when the wind is very strong, Germany has already installed, not the production, but the installed generator power, which is about 50 gigawatt. And yes, and then to balance this, actually, brown coal power stations are used, and then frequently the wind is too big, then suddenly all the wind turbines are stopped, and then you have to already have the brown coal power stations running and the fire should be on, and then you can switch it over to brown coal production. So Germany's emission, dirt emission or CO2 emission, is actually increased since this 50 gigawatt wind power is done, so it is counterproductive even from the point of view of CO2. The other trouble is that it is extremely expensive. Here are wind turbines, which are floating wind turbines. They are installed by Statoil, now it's called Equinor, change the name, near Peterhead, which is 25 kilometers out of the sea, so it should not disturb the population in Scotland. The height of this tower is 253 meters. The diameter of the propeller is 154 meters, so huge, bigger than an A380 airplane. And then it has a weight of 2,200 tons of steel, and the ballast that it should not tip over has 8,100 tons. So even the production of this thing would need about 3 or 4 years of production from the windmill to carry the cost of that production. So that is awfully expensive. And how much it produces? The generator on the top of the turbine is 6 megawatt, relatively little. And then we know, and it cannot be bigger because otherwise it is too heavy for the tower, and it's 250 meter high. So what we also know, I mean, this is little arithmetic, so maybe I should not repeat it, that the power of the wind depends on the speed. And here is a graph that it goes up with the third power of the velocity. And the wind can go up to very high velocities, but the wind turbine is working and not stopped until 25 meters per second wind speed. That's a reasonably strong wind, but I was sailing in a wind which was much bigger than this. And then, if we take the energy of the wind, that is very different at 25 meters per second and at very small wind, like 5 meters per second. That's not a very big wind. And so the production is showed by this blue line, and the wind energy is shown by the red line up there. And how much is it quantitatively? So the wind energy goes up to 185 megawatt at around 25 meter per second wind, and only produces 6 megawatt from 135. So the effectivity at high wind speeds is 3.2%, awfully bad, and awfully expensive this to make it, this one. And the maximum effectivity is 18%, which is also probably the worst from any kind of energy production. So it is, for example, much worse than any internal combustion engine. This is all made into heat, and this picture is a proof of it. One would say that, okay, the wind energy is there and you can use it again. But if you try to do that, then the next one and the next one will already get no coherent wind or laminar wind, so it will not produce much or maybe nothing. And that is seen in a situation where the humidity of the air is high, then the water content of the air due to the turbulence is condensed, and this heat which comes from the condensation is huge. So you make a latent heat, that is the condensation heat, which heats up a whole territory of many hundred or thousand square kilometers. So it makes a huge cloud. So that is actually a huge emission of extra entropy. That is the best one. This is not so bad. So there are other energy forms which I would not discuss. How many minutes? I have no more time. Okay, so I don't discuss these. One essential point is that biofuels, fundamentally, all of them are wrong. It's the biggest crime one can do, burning highly complex material and reducing it to dust and ashes. That is absolutely considered to be a crime. And even if you count up there is a publication, 100 pages, by this author, that even the invested energy is also huge to create biofuels. So if you consider all the things which go into the agriculture in this production, that is much, much more which comes out. Okay, so storage is the only reasonable storage is water power. There are different methods. Water power is good efficiency. Lithium ion batteries are also good, but about two or three orders of magnitude less than the pump hydro station, and you cannot make so many batteries because, of course, that would be too difficult. Here is the different versions of it. Let me go further. Now, it's discussed very much that water is very useful resource, particularly drinking water or irrigation and so on. Now, and here is an example also from our president, János Áder, who gave an example that when the water is used for irrigation and it's not kept, at two different years, at 2011 and 2015, you see that the water level went so much down that one could not actually have the ships using, and we would like to keep the water in our rivers. And the only way to do that is to have dams. Otherwise, the water will go away, and then we will not have the water. So we will have this second picture. So if we look at the if we look at the Danube, then this middle part is from Morva up till Drava. That is the Hungarian part. And
that is Csernai, the
Volga. That's a river, yes. Where was it? Yeah, here on the little bit right at Orsova, it goes into the Danube. Yes, that's the river Cserna, comes in from Vajdahunyad, that is Dracula's castle, and ends up in the Danube. So that's just indicated there. But if we look at the map, this is, for example, Germany and Austria. More or less every 10 or 20 kilometer has a dam. And if we look at the Hungarian part, there is not a single one, which is, I would say, it's almost a crime. Otherwise, it would be a storage for energy. It would be a bridge. It would ensure shipping. It would keep water for irrigation and drinking. So that is all, as a matter of fact, the only solution of all these problems is to have about three dams, which is already planned before the First World War. Okay, now the final comment is that this is a world total energy consumption. If we want to calculate it in yearly in gigawatt hours, then this is 168 gigawatt hours, and actually doubles in every 50 years. So this is the present one. The electric energy is about 15% of it, but it doubles even faster. It doubles in 36 years. And then, if we look at it, then the solar radiation is, as a matter of fact, not so much, it's more, but not so much more. So when the population and the development goes further as it goes now, we will soon reach an effective amount of waste heat, let's say about 100 or 200 years, which is really comparable with the solar radiation, and then you will really see the result of warming, not due to CO2, but due to our own waste heat production. So the way to avoid it is to increase efficiency and not use sources which are having efficiency. You have to have things which are having 100% efficiency, or you can use actually nuclear power. This is one of them, which is ITER. Here on the very middle of the picture, there is a little thing that is the fusion reactor. Actually, it's very huge. Here you see on the left-hand side, there is a round thing. It is still under construction. This house on the right will be put or pulled over it. And here is actually, there is a big tokamak tube. It's a torus where the fusion will take place. And here is a man, and that is the section of the torus. So that is a huge monster. We are working on another one, which was already mentioned in the talk of, I think, Norbert Crow, that in the US one should try to make mini hydrogen bombs of 1 millimeter size, ignited by many lasers, and in the Lawrence Livermore laboratory they have 192 lasers, and they are still not successful. Here in the middle of that little golden so-called hole room, there is this 1 millimeter hydrogen deuterium tritium fuel, and that is what want to make to explode. And actually it is already quite successful, but not completely. So part of the fuel target is actually exploded. But we have a new idea combining relativistic fluid dynamics and nanotechnology from the group of Professor Crow, which can make the ignition constant at, everywhere and avoid all the problems. And then here is where we plan to have it, at Hungary. There is this European Laser Infrastructure LI in Szeged. And in that building, which is indicated by the arrow, we are expecting to have a large laser which can do that. We need only two lasers, not 192, to do this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Csernai, bringing sustainability from a physicist point of view.